This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today I'm in Compton, California, and I'm visiting a really cool farm that is more about than growing food. It's about growing people as well as places. And so we are at Alma Farm, and the thing is, the farm stand is only open on Sundays, but every other week. So you want to check to see when they're open at Alma Farms, their website, link down below in the description, as well as their check out their Instagram, follow them on my Instagram. Luckily, I happen to be in town when they are open for their farm stand, so I got to visit it. And honestly, if you guys live in the Compton or even the greater LA area, or coming in from out of town, I definitely recommend you guys visit them, because they got some amazing food and they're doing some amazing work with the community. And that's what I really want to share with you guys today, more than just about the farming, which is a part of what they're doing. But you know, for Alma Farms, it's a lot more than just growing the food. So as you guys can see, there's like a sporting field up here in the front. And basically this property here was like pretty much abandoned. It was like a softball field, I guess. And they converted this to like a little, you know, soccer play area for kids. But the farm is in the back property, and they started with a smaller area and then they totally expanded and got larger. One of the things they strive to do is actually make the farm really inviting to people, right? And you know, I've visited a lot of farms in my days, and like I would say that they've done a good job, because Alma Farms, in my opinion, is like the most inviting farm that I've like been to in my life. Because check it out, you walk through, it's like really nice open space. And it's just really neat and orderly and tidy. You know, this is also to, you know, hopefully help get the community on their side. Cause you know, the community doesn't want to see something that looks unsightly and a big food forest that looks all jungly and unmanaged and taken care of. This is very manicured. Check this out. They got the sign here. And then more importantly, they, you know, a lot of farm stands that I've visited, like almost all of them are always at the base of the property, and you never get to go into the property or into the farm to see it, right? They just specifically designed this so that actually you have to walk through part of the farm so you can like, you know, look at the farm and then get to the farm stand that's set more further back in the property. Furthermore, they have many programs here. So one of the programs they do is for kids, and this is like their little kids area where they have like what, peas in a pod kids programs. So like kids from the community could come, of like 30 kids or more, and they give like little classes. And they'll like question the kids and have like little games where they'll actually hand out like Alma bucks, and the kids will win this, you know, money that's not play money. It's actually good for things at the farm stand so they can actually buy healthy food, which is amazing. These raised beds here are specifically designed for the kids. And if you guys have kids, the number one thing you guys should plant if you have kids are what they planted right here, radishes. You know, many people don't know that you could eat the greens of radishes, much like you'd eat collard greens. You could pick these and eat them in a salad. But kids love to pull, I mean, I'm not gonna pull up one of these radishes, but kids love to pull up the radishes, and like you could literally eat them right out of the ground because they look red, they look nice, and they have a nice bite to them. I mean, I remember as a kid myself, you know, when I'd go to my grandparents' house, you know, the farmer next door would grow the radishes and I'd pick them up and eat them as a kid. Like every kid should be able to pick their own radishes and actually know where food comes from. So I really appreciate that. A big part of Alma Farms is actually educating children, future generations, about eating healthy. Not only do they, you know, let the kids pick their own food and have these areas and these raised beds to play with, they also, you know, teach kids about how to prepare the food and, you know, prepare it properly. Because, I mean, kids, I mean, when I went to school, they did have home economics. We had to, like, learn how to make food. It wasn't healthy food. But, you know, here they're teaching kids how to, you know, make healthy things out of the fruits and the vegetables. Yeah, so this is a great place, you know, actually to source food, but also to bring your family. Like there's so many families that are doing like some weekly shopping here, and you can see this is their farm stand. It's basically just set up in a whole row, and they got all the fresh food, a lot of it which they grew, and some of it, you know, they distributed from other farms that are in the local area. I think they said it's within like 250 miles or something. So all the food here is all locally grown. And actually I want to go over this sign here, because this sign is quite important. It actually goes over the mission of like Alma Farms. So it says, we exist to reclaim lives of formerly incarcerated people, repurpose land into productive urban farms, and reimagine disenfranchised communities in LA as a hub for transformation. And you can check them out at almabackyardfarms.com and Alma Backyard Farms on Instagram. So while it is called Alma Backyard Farms, right, they actually started on Alma Street, like in Los Angeles, They are no longer in a backyard. That was their first model, but they've transitioned a lot since they've actually been, you know, as a nonprofit since they started in 2013, which is almost 10 years now as I'm filming this in 2022. So they've come a long way, and they basically used to just get any property and do backyard stuff, but now they're kind of, they've outgrew the backyards and the and going from small little places to, you know, there's too much work to do that. So they've kind of expanded their vision, whereas they're still kind of like in the community backyard, but not necessarily in backyards anymore. So they're like, they have several locations now. I think they have this one in Compton, San Pedro, and even a site in Riverside, that they're gonna duplicate this similar model where they're basically growing food for the community to create more resiliency. You know, one of the big things, and Alma really got popular during the pandemic when you could still, you know, be outside, and they helped a lot of people with, you know, they actually had to get into traffic control because there's like such lines of people in their cars waiting for them to bring out the food as a community distribution food hub. And they've learned a lot of things through that experience as well, like how to store food properly, that I'll show you guys some of the more technical aspects of how they run their farm here. But more importantly, I think that before they close it up, and actually they're kind of getting sold out because I got here several hours ago, I want to show you guys actually what's left available, you know, for sale at their farm stand. So the first thing I'm gonna say about this farm stand is that like these are affordable prices. Like for me, this is like prices that I saw 10 years ago at like farmers markets. Like you can't get things like this affordable. I mean, some things they like had free. They had free limes. You know, here's a white tropical guavas, 2 for $1, like, you know, all locally grown, some grown here. Lemons, 3 for $1. That's an amazing deal. They had persimmons, 3 for $1, 33 cents each, man. You go to a store, like, yeah, try going to Whole Foods. What are persimmons? Like $2.99, $3.99 a pound. They had like passion fruits, 50 cents each. Like mangoes, California grown mangoes, 2 for $1. And of course, let's not forget all the greens. Pretty much they grew all the greens, like the collard greens and the kale, all here. Super affordable prices. What is it? $2 each, or $3 for $5. And then some of the things they also, they grow in their other locations and bring it here. So like some of the lettuces, $2 each, or $3 for $5. They got bok choy, bitter melon greens. They grew the eggplants. I'll show you where they grow these. These are like $2 for $1. Or these, this is what I got today. Actually, I got a couple of these baskets of these mini eggplants. Like, this is a lot of labor, guys. And these are cool, like heirloom mini eggplants. These are so good in the instant pot for 0 minutes. $2. They got bitter melon. And they also work with some local farmers to bring in, you know, to fill in, so you can kind of get a more complete experience instead of just getting a few items. So they got like carrots and celery. It's all organic and locally grown here. They also have a whole bunch of different, you know, spices, and they work with other local, you know, farms and local businesses to bring some of the products in to make them available to the community as well. And besides just the fresh food they offer, they also have some prepared things. So they'll like make like smoothies and drinks, you know, for people actually in their little area where they do the food prep. And they also bring in like local community, you know, breads and other local foods that actually they buy wholesale, and they have very minimal markup and sell the community to, once again, create better access for higher quality food, you know, to people in maybe not so advantaged areas. Another thing they do is they do the cut flowers. So they are super beautifully arranged. A lot of them they actually grow themselves here, but some of them they get from the local wholesale, you know, flower mart, but they just arrange them really nice to, you know, bring beauty, you know, to your homes. Bye. All right, so I got their brochure here, and you could probably check out their website. But anyways, they have they highlight people, plants, and place. And I think it is quite unfortunate in agriculture today that we really put the emphasis on the plants and we forget about the people. You know, the people that are gonna consume the food, the people that grow the food, the community in general. And also we forget about the places. I mean, they are literally transforming backyards, or, you know, vacant lots that are non-productive, and turning them into a productive space to grow the plants, to build the people, to build the community. And, you know, part of that, especially in agriculture, I've seen, you know, a lot of farms are really designed well in terms of maximizing the space to grow up the most amount of food. Like, I mean, my front yard and backyard, I maximize the space to grow the most amount of food because, I mean, it is my personal backyard. But see, Alma Farms has a little bit different purpose, and their purpose isn't to just grow the maximum amount of food. It's to, you know, think of these things in balance. You know, once again, people, plants, and places. So, you know, literally coming to their, you know, farm stand and visiting their farm, you got to walk through their farm. And this is another area of their farm, like the backside of the farm. In the backside of the farm, like, you could surely pack in a lot more plants and raised beds here. I mean, these are nice, huge walkways. I would never do this in my house unless I had an acreage, which I don't. You know, but these are nice, huge walkways, and they're a lot more inviting than a thin, narrow. I mean, seriously, at my house, my walkways are this wide, just enough to get through. because I just want to have more beds so I could grow more food. But that's not necessarily their goal here. Look at this. Like, this is what I really love here. Like, when you walk into this space, it just has nice, like, you know, pebbles on the ground. But it's just, like, really nice and open, airy, and inviting. And so much so that they just, like, really invite the public back into this space, into the raised bed garden area. And they have, like, picnic benches with, you know, umbrellas up if it rains or to get some shade, to just kick back so you could buy your food, kick back, have a meal, eat here with your family, with the community, meet with others. It's just, like, really cool to see this space because I've never really seen this done at other farms I've visited in the past. And that's, you know, a big part of their message here. All right, so in this part of the episode, I really kind of want to get into the nitty-gritty about, you know, how they grow food here in Compton, California. You know, and kind of some of the strategies and techniques they use so that you can learn from this. Another big part of this video for me, for you guys out there, is that, you know, I believe there should be like an Alma Backyard Farms in like every city in the country that, you know, helps to get people who are formerly incarcerated back integrated in the community and actually help in the community, give them a purpose in life, but more importantly, bring the healthy food back to insecure, you know, localities that like don't have grocery stores. I mean, in my opinion, I'd rather this than a grocery store because food's a lot fresher and can be a lot healthier for people. And, you know, I'm surprised that they just aren't swamped. I mean, they're almost closing, but there's hardly anybody here. But when we were here earlier, there was a lot of people. And, you know, even though this doesn't look so super huge, you know, over a year, I think they grow about 125,000 pounds of produce that they distribute, you know, to the local community. And that is putting a big dent to get people to be healthier. And once again, as you guys know, my message also to you guys that are watching me today is that eat more fruits and vegetables than the healthiest foods. And of course, they're also the easiest to grow yourselves, and that's what I'm going to show you guys in this part of the episode. So you can see they just have standard, like, row crops here, which, you know, makes it kind of look more legit, like a real farm instead of just raised beds. I think these are all planted in, like, cut flowers, because actually they're quite profitable. And, you know, each plant has a story, and I don't know the exact story about this, but we'll be interviewing Richard later about the story of this. But this is basically an okra that's like a hand-down heirloom from a family member or something like that, that actually this is like the good kind of okra. So they grow very specific plants for certain reasons. And yeah, so like we are here in December, and look, like this okra is towering over me. It's having some challenges because the weather's getting cold, but like look at how like big the base of this okra is. I mean, if you guys are in Texas, you guys aren't impressed or anything. But because okra is a nice southern crop, but yeah, love the humidity, love the heat, even it loves the dry heat. I mean, I grew it in Vegas, but these plants are insane for sure. Over in this area, they basically, for this time of year, they're growing the sugar snap peas. And in the summertime, they basically do single string tomatoes, like up these trellises. So this is like the row crop area, and then now we're moving into some of the raised beds. And I mean, these raised beds are just nice and well manicured. You know, they know that in certain times of the plant's lives, like sometimes some plant parts gets diseased or, you know, dies, and you got to cut those off and move them out. You know, they got a big compost pile that they're composting. But it's like that for like in real life, in life with people too, right? Sometimes things aren't happening right for you. You got to just cut that part off, get rid of it, compost it, whatever, and then move on with your life, right? So that's a big part of what they're doing here. So they're not only doing that plants, but they're also doing that with the people. And like, look at all this beautiful kale. Like, this is like how I want all my raised beds at home to look like. Nice manicure if you just like take a look at down that. I mean, these are like literally little curly kale trees. Just looking real good. Now, the cool thing about how they harvest here is, you know, like a lot of farmers may just cut down the whole plant and just sell you the whole plant. They come and they'll like harvest, okay, harvest this leaf, and this leaf. They'll harvest like six leaves, put it together as a bunch, and then sell it. So if you harvest your kale in this way, I mean, it could live a year or longer depending on when you initially planted it. So I mean, you should plant your kale in the wintertime so it establishes itself, and then it could grow over the summer depending on what variety and how hot it gets where you live. Dinosaur kale is probably one of the best ones to grow for like multiple, you know, seasons. And then at some point it'll finally go to seed, unless of course you're growing something like tree collards that could, you know, grow kind of like mostly indefinitely. So even in December here, I mean, they still got basil. Now, yes, this basil is definitely hurting. I could see it. I mean, this is definitely some heat stress. I mean, my basil had to come out like last month already. But yeah, so they still got some basil, and yeah, they got all this beautiful broccoli. I think they're doing a, like a cut and come again broccoli. So they basically cut off the main shoot. They'll have a nice broccoli head, and then they'll have the smaller side shooting of the broccoli. And of course, I always like to remind you guys that all the leaves of the broccoli, you could eat them just like you would kale or collard greens. They're so delicious. Make a nice wrap out of them, juice them, make them into green smoothies. They're super nutritious. And actually, you know, the broccoli leaves are actually more nutritious than the broccoli flour, which everybody's after. All right, now another cool thing, they like to really repurpose things. And as you guys can see, like I've never seen cold frames like this before, right? All you gotta do is find some old abandoned picnic tables that were like abandoned literally in this field that were just being not used. So they literally converted these into elevated cold frames by building basically a little mini greenhouse on top. So now this way you don't have to bend over into the cold frame. You can sit up, and if they give classes, you know, kids could sit here and they could open up the cold frame and look at this on the inside, right? They got a thermometer. I put my hand in here. It's nice and warm. I'd actually like to just kind of take a nap in here right now because it's nice and warm, get some good sun. But they're starting like their cilantro in there, and they got kale and onions growing. And check this out, man, the thermometer in here says it's like about 76. So it's actually about 10 degrees warmer than it is just right now. So it's like maybe around 66 these days. But yeah, repurposed picnic tables into cold frames. That's how they do it here. You know, they kind of like look at how can we use what we got to, you know, grow food and make our mission happen. So this is their compost pile where they return all the food waste and food scraps back into the earth, in the soil. They're kind of a little bit backlogged with their compost pile because they just got a chipper that they're gonna try to chip stuff up and make it happen a little bit faster, but they sift off and they'll use this compost, you know, to grow the food. So it's like a recycling system where they're, you know, trying to reuse all the waste that is generated here on the site. Another thing they do that was kind of like, I mean, I saw it when I saw what they're doing, because, you know, they don't necessarily want people in their compost area like I am, but on their nice area where they have the raised beds, at the end of the raised bed, they'll have like basically like a fruit tree right here as a block. So you'll actually, you won't walk into this area, but then they're growing more fruit trees. And actually these are, I think, strawberry guavas, some guavas, you know. So you could even just in a pot, you guys could grow some food. So you don't have to have these big raised beds. You can just grow things in a pot. The next thing that's really important, and I really like the, you know, solidarity, you know, they want to create community, but then also with plants, you know, there's plant communities. So like bananas are known as a community-based plant because bananas like to grow in a bunch, like not just on a bunch, like in a bunch. Right, but bananas like to grow in a bunch. They like to grow next to each other. So, you know, the plant will produce a bunch of bananas and like literally it'll throw out a little baby. So here's the baby one that'll be the next generation, and the parents and the, you know, grandparents are behind them that'll finally get chopped down, and then they'll just compost that next door to feed the new bananas coming up next door. Now, the cool thing about this is that, you know, they try to design systems to, you know, be most efficient with water. So if we kind of go up over here, this is where they do all the washing and prep of the food and whatnot. And they do the washing here in the sink. And then all the water from the sink actually feeds the bananas right there. So it's basically just direct to the bananas. So just the water drain out. So they're reusing the water. And if you look, this area here, the bananas, has really lush growth. But as you get further away from this, the plants are getting less water. They're not growing quite as well. And look at this, I really love, this is like a jungle feel here in their food prep area where you got bananas just hanging out with you. Because once again, they're creating community, not just of the people, but the people and what's our relationship to the plant. So really, Alma Backyard Farm is about creating relationships, people, plants, community. You know, and we often forget this in agriculture when you're just like, oh, it's me dominating over the plants. But remember, you know, we're working in synergy. We're helping them. They're helping us. And so we should remember this in life. Like, we just need to be more like Alma Farms in real life. So one of the focuses here is trying to grow plants that could just be continually harvested, right? Why is that important? Well, because this saves on labor and saves on production. So they could be continuing to start like lettuce plants that they basically generally harvest the whole thing and cut the whole thing down, right? Unless you're maybe growing cut and come again for salad mix, which I didn't actually see here. But they really like to focus on these plants like collard greens, another one of my favorite vegetables. They just harvest the leaves so they could, you know, every week, every bi-weekly when they have their farm stand, they could just go to each plant and harvest one or two leaves off it and make a bunch. And because they have one, two, three, four, five, five beds of collard greens, right? They could have enough collards to feed the community from just these beds by, you know, harvesting one leaf at a time. Also, I like to think that these look really pretty. And, you know, this is the way that I grow my food at home. I just harvest a leaf off a plant, even if they're not this big. You know, and then just harvest one off each plant so I could have a whole salad. And it really doesn't take a lot of collard plants or whatever plant, leafy greens, especially in the winter time, you know, here in the zone 9 or 10 where we're at, to grow enough salad for you guys to eat. So one of the things a good farmer or gardener will learn that is that over time they would have did things a little bit differently, you know, and there's plenty of things that I've done in my garden and that you've probably done in your garden that you would have done differently. You know, because they maybe didn't have they didn't really exactly know. They thought, oh, if I plant one of each kind of citrus, you know, like, you know, lemons, limes, kumquats, all the different types, you know, like grapefruits. I could have all different kinds of fruits. But what they found actually is that if after, you know, growing them all up into when they're big, they found that some citrus fruits grew a lot better than others and some didn't produce that well. And also, you know, it's great to have a big variety, but then they didn't have a large quantity of any one thing. So they found out that, hey, maybe we should have just planted one or two varieties that really performed the best so we'd have a lot more food to distribute, you know, to the local area, to the people, to the community. And so that's what they learned. And now we'll show you the citrus tree that actually does the best for them, that produces like pretty much year round, that they just have an overabundance of this one citrus fruit. All right, so the one citrus fruit that I want you guys as homeowners to have, if you're in a climate that you're able to grow these, and I'm able to grow them, and I have one of these trees myself, so I like them a lot. Actually, this is the Meyer lemon, which is probably their most productive citrus. And also Meyer lemons are amazing because they kind of like, they're not super sour like a standard lemon. They kind of like a little bit of sweetness. And so, you know, you can see they're in different stages of ripening right here. I mean, here's some more ripe, less ripe. But like this tree is like loaded up with fruits, you know, compared this to like the like grapefruit here that was planted next door, right? The tree just has not done as well. It has a few fruits on it, which is great. But look, this tree is just loaded with tons of fruits that could have a bigger impact on the community to provide them more fruits instead of less. And hopefully, you know, for you guys out there, you guys could just grow a Meyer and have a lot more lemons. And yeah, you may have to buy your oranges or grapefruits, but hey, leave that to the experts when they could grow it a lot more effectively than you can, especially if you have a small amount of space. So once again, we are here in December in Compton, California, and it's just cool to me to see eggplants, which to me are totally a summer vegetable. And we're here in like December, and look at these plants, you can tell they're not liking the tad bit cold they're getting. But you can see they're still flowering and producing really nicely. So these are just standard like Japanese eggplants. Once again, they'll trim these up and they're just looking really pretty. I mean, this is like a well manicured but yet productive farm here, you know. And actually here's a Japanese eggplant. But then even more than that, they have these ones, which are some kind of heirloom eggplant. And these are really pretty. I love these. Actually, this is what I bought today here. And they sold like a little carton of these for like $2, man, like little baby heirloom eggplants. I don't even know the variety, but these are so pretty. And do not underestimate the power of eggplants. You know, they have some anti-cancer compounds as shown by science. So the farmers here know that it's just a lot more important than just growing food for the people, which is basically all the raised beds, but it also is growing plants for the other plants. So growing plants that will benefit other plants. So in this area over here that you guys could see the guy that farmer's working on, they basically have like a hedgerow, which is incorporated as part of the garden because they know the hedgerow will attract beneficial insects, the birds and the bees, so that their plants can get better pollinated. Also, you know, they are formally, actually this is a fun thing, let me show you guys this. The fun thing is, like, when they originally put this area in, they put all drip irrigation in, but then the problem is they get in there and they'd hack it up when they're trying to like take care of this area. And then they saw over time that, you know what, the native area really didn't need drip irrigation. Actually, that's what they're doing today. They're literally ripping out all the irrigation and they're just leaving the plants in and trimming them back here in the winter time. That'll do good without irrigation. That will, like, if they've learned that also the time of planting is critical. So for example, if you guys plant some of the natives in the winter time, which is right now, so plant some natives, guys, native plants, right? That not, you don't necessarily eat, but will attract the birds and the bees, the beneficial insects, right? Create some habitat for other creatures besides humans, because humans tend to be human centric. You guys want to learn more about this, you could watch a movie entitled Earthlings. It's probably online, you know, on YouTube or Netflix or somewhere. But that'll really kind of get you thinking about, hey, on the earth, there's a lot more than just humans, right? There's all these other creatures that were living here even before us that we just kind of like take for granted and try to like dominate over them. And, you know, that is not the way that, you know, that they work here or the way I think we should work as a society. So here they're trying to basically grow the natives that were, you know, here before us, that were that could grow without the input, without even having the watering, because they're gonna establish them in the wintertime. They're gonna grow nice deep roots, get established, and then come the summertime, they won't even have to water them because the plants were fenced for themselves. I mean, think about it. When you drive through the Mojave Desert on your way to Las Vegas, if you're taking a vacation, who waters those cactus plants or those agaves or those other plants in the middle of the desert where it barely rains? Like, nobody takes care of these things and they're still growing. So yeah, oh, and there's a butterfly. So that's what they're trying to do in this area. They're trying to basically make that area that they don't have to take care of, so it's actually less work. Maybe they just got to trim it back in the winter time so it doesn't get overgrown, so it looks nice, you know, for the farm and the community. All right, so this is like part of the natives that they're growing. They're like hedgerow to kind of attract beneficials, but also they've done it really nice because they have like a little pathway going through here to like a deck where they would formerly have classes. And the cool thing is sometimes they'll get like bands, so they have bands that'll play music not only to people that are attending, you know, but also play the bands to the plants. You know, plants need music too. There's a bunch of studies showing, you know, hey, I play music to my plants when I'm in that garden because I'm listening to music too, and my plants usually like 80s music. All right, so while they focus on a lot of vegetables here, they also have, you know, local neighbors that, you know, they get fruit from. They have their own fruit trees on their other properties. Here's an existing avocado tree, right? Which is amazing. Let's see if we could. All right, yeah. Fresh avocados, nothing better than that. Now, here's the thing I wanna let you guys know, right? Hey, having an avocado or fruit trees are great. The challenge is, you know, this avocado tree will only produce avocados one time a year. And especially if you have limited space, right? You're growing a big tree, and think about it. For 11 months out of the year, maybe 10, the tree's just growing, taking up space, and doesn't produce you guys any food. You know, whereas vegetables, you could grow vegetables, right? They could grow all year, and the minute they grow a leaf, right, you could harvest that leaf and eat it as a baby green. Even when the vegetables shoot up as a baby and have little sprouts or microgreens, you could eat those. I mean, you're gonna kill a plant. But, you know, that's why I try to focus on, and my channel is called Growing Your Greens, because I believe greens are a much more sustainable way so that you can grow more and higher quality and more health promoting food than the fruit trees. I mean, now if I had acreage, of course I'd have vegetables primary first, but then I'd also have a lot of fruit trees to eat as well, because hey, fruits are amazing foods too. And here's the thing, guys, fruits and vegetables, they each have their pros and cons, and I think you want to eat both of them to be the healthiest and have a wide variety of them as well. So yeah, glad I got a nice fresh picked avocado today. So really love the space and how they utilize the space here at Alma to integrate plants and the people, and how they use the space more importantly, and not just pack in just the plants, and even make use of some of the spaces that they've had pre-existing. For example, this was just a chain link fence that you guys can't see now, because it's covered in passion fruit vines. And as you guys can see, here's plenty of passion fruits that they have that are not even yet ripening up, but they will be ripening soon, that they sell at the farm stand for like 50 cents each. And it, like, if you go to a farmer's market to buy passion fruits, they're like $16, $12 a pound. I mean, I just saw some at the farmer's market yesterday. They're insanely priced, but yet, you know, if you live in Southern California, you should just grow the vine like up one of your chain link fences and have like unlimited passion fruits for free. So just to reiterate, if you guys love to visit Alma Farms, you guys can do it yourself because they are open every other Sunday, right? And make sure you check them out at almabackyardfarms.com or at Alma Backyard Farms on Instagram. And you can actually see the availability every Friday, but they are open every other Sunday. I'm going to show you guys two more parts of the farm before we actually interview one of the founders here at Alma Farms so we can learn about their mission and how they're growing here in Compton and in Southern California. So the first thing I want to say is that the aesthetics here are just really well done. I mean, everything looks pro and professional, and you'd never know that what I'm standing in front of is actually their walk-in cooler space being powered by an air conditioner. Now, this is not new. I've shown a lot of videos where I've gone to farms in the past and showed the CoolBot technique, basically building, you know, a little walk-in cooler, because they really, especially during the pandemic, they learned that they just literally did not have enough storage for the fresh produce that they were harvesting and getting out to the people so that it wouldn't go bad, because, you know, they want to treat people with dignity here and not give them like half-ass rotten food like some places were doing during the pandemic. They wanted everything to look really nice and high class and, more importantly, healthy for people. So they actually had to build this whole facility or this part of this walk-in. And look at this, this looks like a little barn, but if we open this up, check this out, man. Look at the insulation on that. That's insane. Like, that's like several layers of insulation. We could walk in, and this is the nicest CoolBot like fridge that ever walked in. Look, they have a nice CoolBot here, pro, with an air conditioner inside here. It's 40 degrees right now. Look at this, they got panels on the wall, it looks all pro. And check this out, look at the floor, they got a nice floor in here. And then everything's off the ground and really neat and organized for people to take home and all the food. This is what I want though. They got the local grown persimmons, and yeah, you guys missed them. They were selling these guys $3 for $1. Man, and these are high chia persimmons. They're quite rare, and actually these are picked ripe, not like the stuff you buy at the store, right? So yeah, and they got it fully insulated. It's nice and cold in here. They got a little work area, but yeah, this is instrumental for their farm. So yeah, if you guys have a farm and have a challenge with keeping produce fresh, hey, get a CoolBot cooler. I don't know if you guys got to make it this nice, but this is like high end. They're just keeping it real tight here at Alma Backyard Farm. All right, so if you guys come to the farm stand, and here's their farm stand list, you can kind of see everything that they had. They had fruit, bananas. Those are the locally grown ones you guys saw. They didn't have a ton of those, so get here early. Guavas, lemons, passion fruit, persimmons, fuyu, high chia, Asian pears, mangoes, all California grown, mind you. Within, you know, locally grown within like 200 or 50 miles or so. Pomegranates, avocados. The greens today was kale, collards, lettuce, spinach, golden chard, cabbage, bok choy. They also had broccoli, mini eggplants, Japanese eggplants, tomatoes, fennel, long beans, bitter melon, acorn squash, delicata squash, radishes, parsnips, potatoes, carrots, celery, onions. For herbs, they had dill, thyme, mint, and cilantro. So yeah, I mean, you could like make meals out of the stuff you get here. I mean, what would you do with the greens and stuff? Like, to me, like, salads are the best. Eat salads, you could make blended green smoothies, you can juice them. So many ways the greens can be used, and I want all you guys to eat a good percentage of greens every single day. My goal every day is to eat 2 pounds. Now, I don't always meet that, but you know, I always at least get 1 pound of leafy greens in me. They're essential for a healthy diet. So while they do have that CoolBot storage and like it's sitting at 45 degrees because they grow plenty of vegetables in the summertime, right? They found they had a problem because they couldn't store some of the summer vegetables. That just 45 degrees is too cold for tomatoes. And I don't want you guys storing your tomatoes in the fridge because it's too cold. They're gonna get cold damage. Same thing if you guys store bell peppers, tomatoes, eggplants in the fridge. They are warm season crops. You're gonna damage them. So they're like, how could we like store our warm season crops without them going bad? So then they have this other little store area that stores their regular stuff, but they also have another fridge. So check this out. Right, so this is hardcore because I mean, I do this at my house and I've never seen another farm do this. So I really appreciated when I saw this. That's what I wanted to share with you guys. So they got this fridge right here, which is just a standard Hobart fridge. And you guys know a standard fridge might go down as low as 40 degrees, but that's still way too cold for, you know, summer fruits like tomatoes and whatnot, right? So they got one of these. Check this out. This is like the CoolBot, but to keep a warmer fridge area. So they basically, this fridge stays at about, I think, around 50 or 60 degrees. And they got this Inkbird set up. So this Inkbird registers a temperature inside the unit, and it has a plug, so it'll cycle the power on and off to the fridge so that the fridge doesn't ever get too cold, and that way it's off currently. They could store their warm season fruits in there. So, you know, like in my house, I have three fridges, and yes, most people think I'm crazy, and I am crazy, but I have three fridges. One is set around 50 degrees for what? For my like warm season fruits and things that don't like things too cold. I also have a fridge set at like 34, 35 degrees. That's like for my juices and like for like kale and collard greens. Lettuces that like cold, because that'll make sure they don't go bad faster. And then I have a mid fridge, it's like 45 degrees, that'll have things in between. So like some of my fruits, like persimmons and different fruits in there. My pomegranates are in that fridge. So, you know, I mean, if you guys can look this up, like USDA makes best post-harvest practices for different fruits and vegetables. And you can look up in the manual, like it's a big PDF you can download. They have eggplants stored at this temperature, so you have the longest shelf life to keep the food the freshest the longest. And that's what they're doing for you guys here. So many of you guys don't understand what goes on behind the scenes at many farms, not just Alma Backyard Farms. But, you know, that's what they go through. This basically serve people with dignity, not give them like shit fruit that's been chill damaged. And then they give it to people thinking like, oh, yeah, you should eat this. No, they're like doing their best to give you guys high quality stuff. Actually, at super affordable prices. All right, so the farm stand is pretty much closing. They're kind of closing up since they've been here since 6 a.m. working. But before I do the interview with one of the founders, I really wanted to talk to you guys about one of their main missions here at Alma Farms and what I've hopefully tried to show you guys today. It's about, you know, they do what's called relationship farming, right? That's very important. It's, you know, relationships not only between plants and different kinds of plants. So you can see, you know, this is more of a native slash herb section of their farm where they have all different kinds of plants, and all the plants are relating to each other. You know, there's mycorrhizae, there's bacteria in the soil that are basically communicating to each other, and they're relating to each other and all this stuff. But also, you know, so plants relationships to each other are relationships. So people and plants relationships. Hey, you know, I want this plant to propagate, so I'll cut you off and I'll root you and then I'll plant you somewhere else. So like we're helping them. At the same time, they're gonna give us some of their food, some of their plant parts so that we could eat and survive. We're helping them. You know, we let them go to seed, we collect their seeds, we share seeds with others so that they could grow them, you know, spreading them out. So once again, it's all about relationships here at Alma Farms. You know, plant people relationships, also relationships with the property, with the land itself, the place, right? And how this place impacts what they grow, because some crops would grow better here at their location here in Compton versus their location in Riverside or their location in San Pedro that has different microclimates, you know? So they're trying to start basically farm stands in both the San Pedro and the Riverside to basically branch out so that they could help more people and create more community. And I definitely think that there should be more people making Alma Farms in other places. Now, Alma does not have a program where they could train you to start your own, but if you come down here on one of their open days, you know, they'll answer all the questions. Glad to give you a tour if they have some time on one of their open days and share with you guys all they know about what they've done to make this great impact in the community, as well as grow a lot of healthy food and distribute over 100,000 pounds of fresh foods to people in needing areas that are literally food deserts. All right, so as you guys can see, they're packing up the farm stand. This was one full of fruits and vegetables. Now here's the thing, guys. Like when their farm stand is done for the day and they didn't sell the food, nobody wanted it, they'll donate this food to local different, you know, food banks and little kitchen, you know, food kitchens that serve people in need. So that's amazing. So like this is a whole cycle that, I mean, if you guys own a farm, you guys could also donate your scraps. Don't just bring it home and compost it. Hey, that is a use of your food that you've created. But I think a better use of food is, hey, run that through people first and then let them, you know, get all the nutrients out of it and then let, you know, deal with their compost on the other end, but you don't gotta do that. So yeah, so I mean, this farm overall is just one of the most amazing farms I've ever visited. And I encourage you guys to visit them, follow them online. If you guys have extra money, hey, they are a nonprofit and they could appreciate your support, because honestly, they're not making a ton of money from selling the produce at like below market prices. it's lucky for the people in this area that there are big, you know, big, not big people with foundations and rich people that are basically, and they write a lot of grants to get money so that they can continue this operation, which I think is amazing. And I think this is one of the best uses of grant money and donations that you could do with any extra funds that you may have and have accumulated over time. So the final thing I like to do is I like to interview one of the founders here to really kind of, I mean, hopefully I've shared with you guys a lot of what this organization does to the best of my ability, but you know, we can learn more from talking to one of the founders directly, who actually, interestingly enough, when he started Alma Backyard Farm, actually found me through Google, and my videos and my instructional videos helped them get farming. So like, I feel partly a little bit responsible for getting them started. So I'm really glad to making this full circle and be able to be here and share their message with you guys. All right, so now I have the pleasure of interviewing Richard Garcia from Alma Backyard Farms. And actually, this is one of the founders. There's originally three founders, and he is one of them. And we're gonna ask him some questions about why this was started, how he grows here in Compton, the mission of Alma, and how maybe you guys could even improve in your gardening and farming and your connection with community. So the first question I have for you, Richard, is, you know, I want to meet Alma. Now that I've been to Alma Farms, I want to meet Alma. She sounds like an amazing person that started this farm.
Yeah, oftentimes we're there's a thought that there's a person named Alma, and that's who the farm's named after. And one of our co-founders, Erica, she's often called Miss Alma. But the reason why we're called Alma Backyard Farms, there's a lot in the name. Alma in Spanish means soul. And we grow a lot of food not just to satisfy the palate and your taste buds, but we grow food to satisfy the deeper hunger of the soul, which include things like yearning for community and connection, a sense of healing. So that's the reason, the fundamental reason why we grow our food, because we're growing community alongside it.
Yeah, and I mean, unfortunately, a lot of farms are growing, you know, food for profit, and they're forgetting about, you know, the greater mission that I think other farms should have, such as what Alma's doing here. So Richard, another question I have for you is, why was Alma started? Like, why was this farm started? Did you just want to provide food for the community, or was there something else?
So we started experimenting with growing food when we worked at Home Grill Cafe. And we noticed that working alongside plants in raised beds and in rows allowed for a different conversation to spark. One of our Genesis stories was about one of the homegirls who was working with me on a day where we had to go tend to a small farm in Boyle Heights. And I noticed that she was oddly quiet as we were driving in the van with materials like soil, seedlings, ready to plant. She was very quiet when we were driving down that street. And so when we finally got to our destination, we parked and we were offloading material. I had to ask her, like, why are you so quiet today? It's not like your normal, usual self. And she said to me that the last time in her former life as an active gang member, the last time she was driving down that street was because she was looking out to do a drive-by shooting. And she was juxtaposing that past life with her present life, where she now discovered that her hands were in a position to plant new life. So she had this awakening, if you will, of planting new life. And as an observer and witness to this insight, we wanted to focus on providing that experience and creating that opportunity for many more people. And that's happened repeatedly, where people have discovered more about themselves, they've experienced a level of healing, and they've experienced a level of giving back to others by growing the food that feeds and nurtures communities today.
Wow, that is amazing. So the thing I'm gonna say is that, you know what, whether you're, you know, a homegirl driving through the old hood or whatever, or whether you're just a standard person like me, we have all gone through some kind of trauma in our lives, whether you had some messed up childhood, whatever. I mean, I've been through some trauma too. And here's the thing, guys, like if you guys ain't gardening, you guys need to start gardening. Why? Because when you can get your hands in the dirt, you're gonna start communing with the plants. You get, you know, the plants don't talk back at you. You're gonna nurture them. And here's the thing, without them talking to you, they're gonna nurture you too. Cause when your hands are in the soil, we're living more natural life. And you just, it just like relaxes you and does some kind of healing. Now this is not a substitute for seeing professional care and medical things if you guys need that stuff, but just by gardening, you know, it just calms my nerves down and just, I think, makes me a better person. So I think everybody should have a deep connection with nature, getting their hands in the dirt, growing some food, also, you know, doing this in community, getting other people that you could garden with, talk to them at the same time, while you're just kind of feeling maybe a bit more vulnerable, you know, because you're in nature and you're not in a high-pressure situation where you might open up a little bit more and be more open to, you know, bettering your life, bettering the community around you. You know, better people makes better communities. So, man, the work here you do, so important, like more important than like a lot of farms that I visited that just grow the food for the profit. You know, so here's a question for you, Richard, is if somebody just has a for-profit farm, how could they just take a little tidbit of the stuff you do? Cause you go like hardcore deep. How could they, what advice would you give them so that they could just maybe move a little bit more towards thinking more than just profit, but thinking about the community, thinking about the people and you know, their specific place. Cause I know these are all important for, you know, for you guys at Alma here.
Yeah. All right, John, I got three things for you in terms of how, you know, people who farm could help us out. The first thing is sharing your surplus. A lot of people are hungry. There are a lot of places ready to receive really well-grown food. And I think if we could share surplus, we'll help feed hungry people. The second thing is to educate youth. I think young people are really inspired by this type of work where they want to get involved. And so if there are ways you can invite youth, young people, to see what it takes to grow food and feed people, having them visit with something as simple as a field trip, a day trip where they could even taste food growing out of your farm would be great. And the third thing is to create a space for community to visit so that community could experience firsthand the farm as a place for people also, where it's not just this out in the distance reality, but it's a place that they're really a part of. And in the end, John, I think it's, we're growing community together. If we could come to that realization, I think our world could be a better place.
Yeah, I mean, actually, I got a shirt, actually. It says, it's something like, keep the culture in agriculture, right? Because it has been taken out. We got to, once again, it's a community culture, you know, that Richard and what they're trying to do here at Alma Farms is trying to do. So like, Richard, some follow-up questions on that is, you know, hey, sharing your surplus is great, but how do you do that in a system that is not really set up? I mean, a lot of food banks are set up for canned goods and all these things, but like they can't really deal with fresh food. So like, how would somebody in the middle of Chicago or, I don't know, Kansas, like how would they donate their surplus? Because I mean, it sounds great, but how would somebody actually do that? Like,
okay, so at the local level,
yeah.
I'm familiar at the local level.
Yeah, just
here.
Explain the local level
at the,
how
at the
you
local
would do
level
it here.
Here
yeah.
There are really neat partners that we've worked with that helped us supply food, especially during the height of the pandemic. Organizations like Food Forward, where they either make sure to harvest fruit that otherwise would be falling down. They also help gather fruit that farmers are not distributing. And they make that available to other local organizations. There's another organization called Farm to People, where they ensure that farmers could keep growing their food by making a purchase of their food and also supplying that food to either food banks, to community organizations like us, or even to places like Food Forward, just finding the destination. So there are people, there are organizations who make it a point to find a destination for that food.
Oh, wow. So the farmer doesn't have to go into that because that's not like what they want to get into.
Right.
That's cool. Right. I didn't know there's organizations like that.
Yeah. There are quite a few. And I think that's part of the legwork. I think some people are really good at doing one thing, like the farmer's really good at growing a particular crop. They may not be the best at the logistical part of getting that out there, but there are organizations that are willing and generous to say, I'll go there, I'll even get a truck out there and get that food to the local city, local community, and distribute it at that level, taking that burden from the farmer. And then so much doesn't go to waste.
Mm. Wow, it's amazing. Yeah, and then number two would be like, the children, right? The children are the future farmers of America. And unfortunately, you know, we're not getting enough kids that want to be farmers. Hey, it's great if they want to be firemen or policemen or whatever they want to do. But man, we need to get more kids to be farmers, to like show them that farming is an amazing task, amazing thing to do. Not only can you make a living, but you could help other people grow food, have a connection with nature as well. So yeah, reaching out to local schools, let them know that you do field trips, that you will give classes. I mean, they give classes here to kids and teach them and just to get their kids' hands in the dirt to grow stuff. You know, I'm all for, you know, every school should be teaching kids how to grow food and the importance of eating healthfully in our fast food culture and food desert culture. And the third thing is I want to talk about more with you guys, because like I haven't been to a lot of farms that like try to integrate community. I really love how like literally you think when you design the farm, you think of it as your living room. And how would you design your living room so that it's inviting, so that, you know, people could come and hang out like literally in the middle of raised beds and, you know, hey, listen to the music, listen to live music, listen to the, you know, music that's playing, you know, have a nice little area where they have all the different, you know, food that you're selling to people, and they could just kick back and have a nice family outing. Like literally, like, I mean, I haven't really, I mean, maybe some like farms that I go to that's like a destination farm, I've seen that, but they haven't really done it as good as you guys. So what tips would you give some people out there that just have a traditional farm that where they really don't allow people, to maybe like make it, get them to like start getting some people on the farm, to creating more of a farm community? Because also at the same time, you're creating customers and you're creating a healthier community that's going to actually want to, you know, support the farm and the food that it's growing.
We've managed to create a new kind of traffic. It's, you know, walking traffic, pedestrian traffic. And we designed our farm with the farm stand in the midst of all of the plants and what's growing, so that people could experience walking through, noticing some of the food they're going to source, how it grows, and really developing a connection with their food. A lot of the times, by having community members walk into the farm, go into the farm stand area, they end up breaking out into conversation with other people looking to buy new items or to source a new fruit or a new vegetable. And one of the most edifying things that happens under the farm stand with this sort of design for pedestrian traffic, for conversations, like this is a living room, is people start to share, you know, recipes. They start to talk about how they're going to prepare this, and culture is made more healthy. It's made more strong, just with those conversations over food.
Wow. And so I want to get into actually some farming questions, actually, being that we are in LA, and I mean, it's here in December and you still got eggplants growing.
Right.
I actually want to talk about the okra, because, you know, I showed the okra in the video. And you know, what is the story behind your particular okra? Because, you know, another thing that's very important is to tell the stories of the plants and the specific plants you guys are growing. Because, I mean, they grow very specific plants for certain reasons, like we all do, right? But why do you guys grow the specific okra variety that you guys grow? What's the story of that? And, you know, we all, whether people or plants, yes, they have stories too.
Yes. So our okra seeds were provided by one of the community members, Linda. So Linda heard about the farm because her grandson goes to the school next door, and he would tell his grandma to make him hummus. And she was wondering where he got the idea for hummus. And he said to her, I tried it at the farm by my school. So it really got her very curious about this place, because she didn't remember this as a farm. She knew this as an abandoned softball field. So she visited the farm and she saw we were growing one particular okra. And she noticed that this was an okra that she wasn't very familiar with, and she said to us, I have the okra seeds that people in this neighborhood would love to eat. There is an African American population that is here. A lot of them have roots in New Orleans. So she asked her brother to send seeds over for the okra. So we kind of called those okra, the long okra, Linda's okra. She's given us those seeds, and she actually taught me a trick. I didn't realize this, but with okra, once they're established, you have to cut the water off completely, and then they start shooting fruit like crazy.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that tip either. So
yeah.
And now everybody, all you guys know that too.
So once it's established, you cut the water off, and then they'll start giving you fruit repeatedly. So she shared not only the seeds, but that lesson. And so a lot of what we grow is informed by what the community wants to eat. That really informs us as to how and what we should grow.
Yeah, I mean, that's just the way business works, you know, like provide what people want. You know, don't just, I want to grow this and that's what I'm going to sell, because you might not be successful, you know. I mean, I'm a big fan of taking like opinion polls and asking people, hey, what would you like to see here? Like a suggestion box, you know, what plant should we grow? And see who says, hey, we want this thing, then grow it, you know. And it also, if you grow a lot of stuff and then nobody ever buys it, like there's so many cool things that I love to grow, but I never see them at farmers markets, because I mean, the standard American, I think it's quite sad that most Americans, in my opinion, are not that adventurous. And they just go to the store every week and they buy their lettuce, you know, iceberg, and they buy their tomatoes, but they never buy okra or eggplants or, I mean, there's so many cool fruits and vegetables that I want you guys to expand into. So yeah, and you guys grow a lot of cool stuff here. So getting back into a little bit of farming stuff, Richard, what are maybe the top three crops that you guys grow here that grow really well? So say there's a backyard gardener watching this right now that lives in, you know, Southern California, LA area. What would you say, what grows really easy without bug damage and all these things that, you know, people should grow?
So what I would recommend people start off with, and it's pretty straightforward. I was telling John that we grow a lot of leafy greens, things in the brassica family, like, you know, your dino kale, your curly kale, collards. You could grow those leafy greens because you could keep on repeating harvests. So it's not just a one and done crop like cauliflower, where you'll get one head and you're done and you waited all this time for that one head. So what we do often here is to have moments of repeated harvest. That's one thing. And in terms of caring for pests on kale, curly kale, dino kale, or collards, oftentimes it's as simple as a wash with water. Just a simple spray, that's manageable. Right now, we are also growing what people like. A lot of the root veggies, like the radishes. We have beets in the ground. We have carrots. You could plant also for just the enjoyment of having, if you have small kids at home, I think the awe and the joy when kids rip that vegetable out of the ground and they're amazed by the colors of what they took out of the ground. I think giving children that experience is something worthwhile, and that's another reason to plant, you know, those root vegetables. And then, you know, there's always room for dessert, so why not grow something sweet like the bananas? I always have a sweet tooth, so I would recommend always having something sweet in the garden.
Cool. So let's talk about sweet. Let's talk about some fruits, right? So for you personally, do you like to grow fruits or vegetables more, and why?
I think vegetables require more interaction. So our farm is about creating opportunities for people. So from building the raised bed, learning the carpentry behind it, filling the beds with soil, and then the ongoing attention paid to vegetables, my preference would be grow vegetables. And then the fruits is a fun thing. But some stuff we consider vegetables are scientifically fruit. So there's some debatable part.
Yeah, I mostly meant like fruit trees versus vegetable plants, which you know, tomatoes and eggplants are considered vegetables, but technically they're fruits botanically, of course.
Yes, yes.
So Richard, so talking about fruits, what's like maybe three fruit trees that are, that grows good for, you know, you guys at Alma Backyard Farms?
Three fruit trees.
The best ones. So like say you're a homeowner and want to have a fruit tree that's really productive, because I know you guys have planted unproductive, maybe not as productive fruit trees as some that really just do well in this climate.
I would suggest that in terms of fruit trees, I know we call them banana trees. Southern California, I do bananas. You could fry the bananas, you could eat them off the vine.
You could eat them green for your resistant starch.
You could do that too. Meyer lemons. I think I'm just thinking about what I'd make, and I'm thinking about a slice of lemon on top of a piece of salmon. That's what I'm imagining, with some fresh dill. I mean, that's easy to put together, but you could always do something with lemons, whether it's making a drink, flavoring something, or just fresh squeezed lemon on top of some of your food. That's great. Passion fruit is so easy to grow, and it kind of does its own thing. In the beginning, we were establishing the passion fruit, so it had not yet climbed. But once it takes off, it takes off.
It takes over.
It takes over. The nice thing is, it's not something we pick off the vine. It usually is something we pick off the ground, because it's ready when it drops. So maybe that's a trade-off. It'll make harvest easy. The plant's doing that for us. It'll just drop it on the ground for us, and all we do is pick it from the ground. That too, you could mix with drinks. We've used that to infuse some of our beverages that we make. It's very tasty. Those are three great options.
Yeah, they look like they grow really well, because I mean, they're growing them all here. Yeah, passion fruits, and I mean, I love lemons. I juice a lot of lemons, so if like you want to preserve your juices, you could juice them in there. The other thing I recommend is like cooking with, you know, so instead of buying vinegar, you could actually just use lemon juice as your acid, you know, to get that component of your flavor, whether you're, you know, cooking things in it, you know, with the lemon juice. Like I love lemons. And yeah, with the Meyers, they're sweeter, and I encourage you guys to actually even use the lemon zest, or I just juice the whole lemons with the rind and all, not just extracting out the juice, because there's lots of good bioflavonoids in that white pith part, and a lot of good flavor even in the outer side, especially when, you know, Meyers are quite ripe. All right, Richard, so the next question I have for you is that, what do you see in the future for Alma Backyard Farms? I know you guys have this location here, a location in Riverside and San Pedro, but where do you hope to see Alma in like maybe 5 years from now?
5 years from now, I hope that we could replicate this model of a farm stand. We still have to do this in a place like San Pedro. We don't have a farm stand there yet. We have the area where we're growing currently. I'd love to see a farm stand develop there and have the similar vibe of people coming to the farm, spending time with their family, sourcing the vegetables. So that's in the next 5 years. I'd love to get that going. Maybe the same thing in Riverside. I think, you know, we also don't own any of the land that we pour ourselves into. I think in the future, it'd be nice to own a good amount of land that we could have to increase our production and increase our opportunity to train people and have people work. So that's something in the future we'd like to have.
Wow, I mean, those are some big goals. I mean, they're already keeping this going and then starting two new places, basically. So Richard, like, how can somebody out there in YouTube land who's watching this right now help you guys out? They're like, man, I really like that guy, Richard. I love their concept, what they're doing. And they live in, you know, New York City or whatever. How can they help you out, you know?
I think one thing to remain connected with us is to be connected online if it's not in person. I'd love for people to visit if they're ever in Southern California, they're around Compton or San Pedro, visit us, come to a farm stand. If not, they could visit us online, stay connected with us on Instagram at Alma Backyard Farms. And then, you know, without any money, there's no mission. So if people have something to share, I invite them to make a donation to Alma Backyard Farms. That keeps us going. We make it a point to keep all of our produce affordable. So your donations help to feed people, and it goes far beyond.
Right. Yeah, those are all amazing things. And I mean, I rarely, you know, after seeing the farm, and I mean, literally I spend half a day here already, you know, with Richard and the team here and like checking them out. And I mean, this place is super legit, guys. Like, I love the work they're doing. And even more so, I love it as a customer, because when I walked in, I'm like, my eyes popped out of my head, like, what? Persimmons are three for a buck? Are you kidding me? I just came from a farmer's market yesterday. It's like $4.50 a pound. And let's not even talk about the farmer's market in Marin County, California, where I was like $6 a pound for some of the stuff you get here in Compton, three for a dollar. That's what I'm saying. So yeah, if you guys live locally, man, definitely worth the visit. Support them. You know, they have like a, you know, different kind of sales of like ceramic plates, all like that, you know, really nice homemade ceramic plates that like contributes to the nonprofit, you know, that are donated so that they can continue their mission and the work. They're doing some amazing work here. And if you guys have a commercial farm out there, or even just a backyard garden with extra stuff, yeah, find out how you guys could donate some of that extra food. Bring in kids and teach kids about farming and about, you know, growing food and how much beneficial it is. And more importantly, invite the community in, create community. We could all do these things, as whether we're gardeners or whether we're big farmers or whether we want to start a new project and even really rehabilitate formerly incarcerated people to get them a new life. I mean, it is all great work that you guys are doing here. I admire you guys for, I mean, literally doing this for like 10 years now. This ain't easy, man. I know you've been through all kind of stuff to make it happen. So yeah, check them out. Alma Backyard Farms. I really love this place a lot, man. You guys are like brothers to me. So I'm glad that you invited me out today so that I can make this video and share this with you guys out there in YouTube land. And hey, do me a favor. If you guys like this video, please give this video a big thumbs up, and more importantly, share this with other people so that they can learn about the amazing mission that Alma Backyard Farms is doing here in Southern California, and how literally this could, you know, change the world once again, one community member at a time. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss any new and upcoming episodes. I'll be coming out every 5 to 7 days. You know where I show up, what new farm I'll be visiting, or how I'll just be growing food in my backyard and tell you guys and share with you guys my experiences about growing food and teaching you guys how you guys could do it too. Make sure you click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check out past episodes. The past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food at home, as well as visiting many farms that are doing amazing work out there in the world, like the farm I visited today. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.